talked about this thing. One of them is that in light of all of this ruck being started by Tea Party members, I always think of the fact, as a Native woman, I always think of the fact that that references an event where a bunch of British identified men dressed up as Native people. Mm-hmm. So it always sort of, I was going to go, really? All right. You really want to dress like me? Maybe this isn't what they have. A couple of years ago, my book was burned. People were burning my book in Oklahoma. The reason they were doing that was because I'll save you the sentence right now. We're probably all completely mixed, okay? But I'll tell you one thing for sure. My nation, the Telugu, are absolutely all mixed. If you meet somebody who is legitimately Telugu, we are African, we are European, and we are Native American, and there is no avoiding that. And unfortunately, that's not a sentiment that everybody enjoys, so they were burning my book. The amusing part of that was that it spiked my sales, because none of the libraries in Oklahoma had my book. So essentially, they paid me for the privilege, and I thought it was hilarious. And I wrote this poem about that, essentially. Because my tribal nation has, this is a new thing, and I often start reading and go, I can't see. This is about being a well-established poet. Part of the code for that is I'm old. Because my tribal nation has no poetry award, I choose to view the burning of my books as a version of recognition. A fellowship of saying the uncomfortable, of being uncomfortable, of reminding the entitled and worried that not everything in the world is for them. And if the fact that we have outlived their plans for us makes them so uncomfortable that they forbid others to read other truths, then so be it. Desert cisterns whisper quiet songs of collecting water, of maintaining life, and unexpected fish move in temporary streams. These cottonwoods know a few things about survival, and moths, and the resurrection of frogs through the living touch of something they can track. There is no water in the stream bed that you can see. No water now, but just wait. Dust old, sandstone old warrior songs can't make us invisible anymore. We will dance, change on the ridgeline, on the edge of the mesa. We're etched on the sky by sun or moonlight, and we will glow so brightly that you have to see us. You have to look us in the eye. So be it. Just wait. There's water underground. Water coming. Now, I also wanted to make a point that we are within a rock's throw from an old Ohlone village site here in the Civic Center. And I don't know how many of you knew that. But Friday, I was praying at a sacred spring, Ohlone Spring. And yesterday, I was in the only space in California that's never been held by Europeans. Ever. Indian Canyon. And by Hollister. And we were praying there too. A lot of our warrior songs were designed to make us invisible. And in my nation, we stopped writing them at the end of the 1800s because I think the holders of our lyric tradition thought that they failed. But of course they didn't fail because we're invisible all the time. It worked. It worked a little too well. And so as a descendant of a Red Town family, and the Red Towns for my nation were the warrior towns, as a poet and a descendant of a Red Town family, it's my responsibility to write warrior songs. Now, I kind of fall down that. Pretty much what I write is love poems, and a little bit fluffy, and you know, kind of non-threatening visually to a lot of the people in the good area. I'm a little sneaky. But I've been rewriting those songs so that we get visible again, because it's really necessary, and part of that is not forgetting that this is a lonely territory still. So I just wanted to thank my cousin Anne-Marie Sayers for and other Ohlone leaders for this space and this time for us together to share poems and be and complain a little bit. It's not bad. Thank you. Thank you for the time. I'm honored to have been asked.